Well, welcome to the last chapter of Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 6. We have discussed again the first opening three chapters, 1, 2, and 3 is positional truth, who we are in Christ. Then chapters 4, 5, and 6 is temporal truth, applying that to the everyday walk of life. We live in two realms, toward God in heaven and toward man on earth. We develop our relationship with God, first of all, finding out who we are in Christ, and we live that in front of the world. And chapter 4 is the transition chapter. In chapter 4, it's no longer who we are in Christ. We're the righteousness of God in Him. We have the indwelling Holy Spirit. We're seated with Him in heavenly places, have power and authority over Satan. Now it's don't lie one to another. And now it's get a job and let's get to work and let's work with our hands and living our life and walking in unity toward other believers. We covered chapter 5 last time and talked about the impact of the Christian life on people around us and especially within our family. And now we come to chapter 6, and chapter 6 is going to be the closing thoughts and how to raise up a generation after us. As we walked and looked toward God, our children look toward us. As we walk in God's likeness, walk in God's commandments, the children follow after those things, and we have a successful family. We also carry that over into our business life. That'll be the middle of the chapter. And then, of course, the closing of the chapter, Paul just says hi to friends and to churches and those that are, again, came out of this great revival in Ephesus in Acts chapter 18, 19, and 20. Let's talk about this in chapter 6. In chapter 6, we have the rewards of holiness. And the first place, we have the rewards of walking in holiness toward the world, letting God's light shine through us to them, taking what's in us, letting it work to the outside, working out our own salvation with fear and trembling. What's in us comes to the outside. The first thing that's affected is our family. And we have obedience in our children, the children toward the parents, producing the rewards of the word. And those two things are prosperity and life and long life. And the two things the word of God produces in us, wisdom comes complete with two hands. In the right hand is length of days, and the left hand is riches and honor. This is what comes to a child who obeys the word of God. And through that, again, the child has long life, live a long time in this earth, and it will be well with you. And the word for well, you, is actually the root of the word prosperous, and means you'll have a prosperous life and you'll live a long time. Now, in the Bible, living a long time comes in the right hand and prosperity comes in the left hand. Right is the predominant hand and simply shows that the best of the two is not money and not prosperity. The best is long life. That way you'll live a long time to enjoy the prosperity you have, rather than have a short life and turn off all that over to your kids. And so, but that's what we'll talk about. There is time, you know, we're going to have something to turn over to our kids, but God wants those children to learn. Before they can understand the word of God, they have to understand the disciplines and the teaching that comes from their parents. And parents, you should offer that teaching and offer that discipline in the correct application of the word of God in your life. So parents are not to provoke their children to wrath by demanding obedience, but training and admonishing children through the word of God. There's times I had to spank my children. I remember before I would do it, they knew it was coming, so they were just like shaking and crying and all that. I would simply tell them, listen, I just want you to understand this. I'm doing this because the Bible says to. And once I gave them the spanking, I set them right down next to me on the bed beside me. We sat there until they finished their crying. And I said, now quote to me that verse of scripture, Ephesians chapter 6. All right, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with you, prosperous, and you may live a long time on the earth. I have them quote that and say, you know why I did this? I want to be well with you. I want you to live a long time. I want you to prosper in this earth. That is the most important thing. So again, they understood that. And again, they would cry and all that. But you know what? Through the years, they learned that. And then they turn around, and that's how they train their own children and raise them up. This is the godliness we found in chapter 1, 2, and 3, coming out in the walk of a parent toward their children and realizing the most important thing is not just having a child and not just being a friend with your child. Understand this. Please understand this, parents. God hasn't called you to be a friend to your child. He's called you to be a leader to your children. And parents who try to be their kid's best friend, associate with their friends, what kid likes to have, you know, a 25-year older mother there than they are and trying to be friends with their friends? Understand this. You are a leader to them, first of all. After they leave the house, and they now have a family. Now you can be friends with your kids. You're no longer the mother, the father. You are no longer in that position above them. They're no longer your children as far as submission to you. No, now you become friends with them. Why? Because they're on an equal level with you as far as knowledge of the Word of God, application toward it, walking in life. And now they see a whole lot of things you try to train them in when they were growing up. They go, oh, Mom, I see what you're talking about. Dad, I now understand. And they're teaching their children and again teach them. It's not up to you to be a friend with your children, although be friendly. I'm not saying be an enemy to your child. I'm telling you, quit trying to be a friend to your child and be the leader they need. They need someone to say, this is the direction. We're going to walk in it. You may not understand now, but you will later on. Come on. And with all the griping, complaining, and dragging their feet, they still go with you. But you know what? One day they realize why they had to do that. You're putting discipline in your children. For one day, they're going to be leaving the home, and between your house and the next house they settle in, which will be their own family. In between that time, college, getting a job, when they're single, all this, now the Word will wake them up. The Word will talk with them. The Word will walk with them. The Word will instruct them. And where Mom and Dad used to do that, now the Word will. So you're actually infusing to them, in them, that leadership. But what is this? This is temporal truth. Taking the Word of God, applying it to life. In the previous chapter, the end of it, applying it toward your husband and wife. In this chapter, applying it toward your children, who will eventually apply it toward your grandchildren. That's all found there. In verses 5 through 9 of this chapter, chapter 6, we have the rewards of holiness on the job. Word and Spirit-filled believers learn to submit to difficult and kind bosses alike. I don't like my boss. Well, that's part of growing up. You know what I learned from bosses and from my mom and dad and from others in authority position? I learned as much what not to do as I learned what to do. I've worked for bosses that were not good bosses. But you know what? You suck it up and you do what they ask. And you may not like it, but you know what? You're learning something. And this is the importance of it. Not every policeman's a wonderful person. Not every judge on the bench is a wonderful judge. Not every boss you're going to have, not every teacher you have, people you submit to, coaches, whatever they may be, are wonderful people. And you submit to the good ones, you submit to the bad ones, because why? You're submitting to the position they stand in, not to the fact that you like them or don't like them, but what you do is you learn in the meantime. I've had bosses I've looked at and said, that's good, I'll remember that. But other things they do, I'll go, I would never do it that way. You see partiality in them and think, I want to be impartial. And of course, you struggle with that as you go along in life. But again, you learn that from the Word of God, that you submit to your boss as you do to God himself, realizing he stands in the place of authority over me, which represents a position of God. So, Father, I choose to submit to him. And if you are not faithful in that which is another man's, how will you ever be faithful in that which is your own? God's saying you learn this faithfulness working around people you don't particularly like, people you don't like to submit to, but you do it anyway because it teaches you one day. Now, when you have your own business and you become the boss, you're going to be a much better one, and God can entrust you with more. So it comes back again to that. If you're not faithful in that which is another man's, how will you be faithful in that which is your own? Human bosses may not reward your good works, but God will. If people put you down, step on you, just like back in the Old Testament, Joseph, who worked for Potiphar, his brothers turned on him. Potiphar turned on him. Potiphar's wife turned on him. In every case, God is the one who raised him up. Promotion doesn't come through people. It comes from God. And when you submit to those around you, it's like submitting to God. And God says, I'll be the one that promotes you. I'll be the one that lifts you up. I'll be the one that sees to it. You have higher positions in life and no one can hold you down. So bosses should treat each employee and believer as well as unbelievers with equal respect. God does this with us each and every day. And you would like to have good bosses who walk in the things of God, but you also learn from bosses that you don't particularly respect. Then in verses 10 through 20, we have putting on the entire armor of God, because ultimately your greatest enemy is not your boss. It's not your husband. It's not the coach. It's not the teacher. No, it's Satan himself. And God is simply saying, you have to put on the armor every day to withstand the attacks of Satan and demons in this world. It comes through the world system, governments. It comes through all these things around us. The presentation of the world system comes through advertisements, radio, television, movies, all the things around us, constantly bombarding us each and every day. But you have, with the weapons of God, the ability to stand against every evil force of the enemy and quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one with that shield of faith. The armor of God covers every part of our body and comes from God's word. In essence, every piece of armor is a piece of the word of God. The God's armor covers the waist, covers our breast, covers our feet, cover our chest, cover our head. His sword is our weapon against Satan, and that is quoting the word of God at Satan, just like Jesus did. Satan, it is written, it is written, it is written. That is your attack. The rest of it's defensive, but the one attack we have, that sword that goes after the other one and goes after Satan himself, is the word of God. And pull it out of your sheath and quote it. That's like jabbing the devil every single time with Satan. It is written, because he comes to us and twists the word of God. And says, this verse says this. You go, yes, but it's out of context, Satan. That's not what God meant. Here's what he meant. And use it against him, and he will depart for a season. He will come back. But again, that word is what he cannot stand. His every tactic is to take the word out of your heart, to take the seed out of the ground, to come with birds and steal the seed of the word of God out of your life. You protect that seed, you walk in it, and you protect your life each and every day. Prayer should accompany our study and use of God's word. We're told that. And then in verses 21 through verse 24, Paul's final greeting to team members he has in churches he has been in and leaders of those churches. He speaks to Tychicus. This is Paul and his team send greetings of peace to Tychicus, who was a pastor who traveled with Paul for a while, and he sends those greetings to the church at Ephesus, the saints at Ephesus, and finally Paul leaves them in the hands of God's grace as he closes this tremendous epistle of Ephesians out. Wow, what a great book this has been. Hope you go back and study it even more and more. Hope this has put a greater desire as we go into the next book, which is very close to the book of Ephesians, and it's Colossians. Both of these are incredible doctrinal epistles that line up so closely with each other. We'll see you next time as we open up in the book of Colossians. Have a great day.